we exalt your name. Your children have come to bless your name. We have come to exalt you, Lord. We bless your name, Jesus. Angels are singing.
Just begin to worship the name of the Lord. Just bless Him. We bless you, Lord. Oh Lord, so thou art capable in me, Mofi, or Bemi.
Hallelujah. King. Let's exalt the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our Maker, our Helper, the reason for the season, the reason why we are here. Let's worship the Almighty God this morning. Let's glorify the name of Jesus this morning. Let's exalt the name of the Almighty this morning. Let's worship Jesus this morning. Let's bow before the Holy Spirit this morning. Let's glorify the name of the King of Glory this morning. I am that I am, the Ancient of Days, the Prince of Peace, the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle, the Bishop of our soul, our Redeemer, our Helper, our strength, our shield, our buckler. Oh, we give you praise, our defender. The Lord God Almighty, we adore you this morning. The mighty God, we worship you. Jesus, Prince of Peace, we adore you. The resurrection and the life, we give you praise. Alpha and Omega, we bow before you. The beginning and the end, we worship you. The Almighty God, the one that has no beginning and no end. The Almighty God who is already in the future. We give you all the glory. The one who was, who is, and who forevermore be. Father, we give you praise this morning. Let's glorify the name of the Lord. Let's thank God for the gift of life. Let's exalt the name of the Almighty God, the one to whom we lift up our eyes. Oh, we give you praise, the one that neither sleeps nor slumber. Father, we give you praise, glorify the name of the Lord, that in your family, when you woke up, everyone woke up one by one today. You did not all wake up suddenly. Father, I give you praise this morning. I worship you, my Maker. Thank the Almighty God that we planned this program for 11th of March. And we are here. Father, I give you praise that I'm part of this program. I glorify your name, O God. Father, Lord, that I'm alive to be a part of this program. Thank you, faithful God. Thank you, mighty God. Glorify the name of the Lord, because there is a change of destiny for the better in our lives. Father, we give you praise, O God. Thank you, everlasting God. We worship you. Glorify the name of the Lord that you are gathered in his house this morning. You are not gathering to worship idol. Thank God for the salvation of your soul. In spite of the challenges you went through and we went through throughout the week and in the last few weeks and beginning of the year. Father, I give you praise because of the salvation of my soul. Thank you for your investment in my life. That is why I'm still standing. Glorify the name of the Lord for the blood of Jesus. Satan and his cohorts cannot stand the blood of Jesus. Thank the Almighty God for the power in that blood of Jesus. Thank the Almighty God that the name of Jesus in your mouth is power. Thank the Almighty God that you carry the presence of God. Glorify the name of the Lord for understanding of the word of God, so knowing who you are in Christ Jesus. Daddy, I give you praise this morning. I thank you, King of Glory. Thank the Almighty God. We should not take it for granted that Nigeria is one. We are not at war. It's because there is no war around here. That is why you and I can come to the service this morning. Daddy, I give you praise this morning. Thank you, Lord, that they are not carrying, giving guns to our children to carry. Some countries are having infant soldiers. Daddy, I give you praise this morning. I thank you for Nigeria. In spite of what we are going through, you know you are the God in the midst of us, and we are overcomers. Thank you, Father. Thank the Almighty God that you are an overcomer. I am an overcomer. Father, I give you praise because I'm an overcomer. I am stronger than my enemies. Thank you, my God and my Father. I give you praise this morning. Thank you, Lord God Almighty. Lord, I give you glory. I bless your name. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Quickly, let's open our Bibles to Revelation chapter 3, verse 12. King James, please. Revelation chapter 3, verse 12 says, "Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God." I want you to pray this morning, Father, make me a pillar in your temple. Make me a pillar in your house. Father, make me a pillar in your temple. When you are a pillar in the house of God, you might be the one that is sweeping. If you are not there, they will know that you are not there. is because you are alive and everything about you is still intact. That is why you can be a pillar. God says, I chose you. You did not choose me. Let's glorify. Let's ask God this morning, Father, make me a pillar in your temple. Make me a pillar in your temple. The verse before that tells about overcoming in the hour of temptation. Father, Lord God Almighty, make me a pillar in your house. Every temptation, oh God, Father, let me overcome in the name of Jesus. Make me a pillar in your temple. Make me a pillar in your house. Father, Lord, make me a pillar spiritually. Make me a pillar financially. Make me a pillar, oh God, in the things of God. Make me a pillar, oh God, in the teacher of the word. Make me a pillar in your house, oh God. Father, Lord, concerning the gifts of the Holy Spirit, Father, Lord God Almighty, let them be made manifest in my life, that I will be a pillar in your temple, oh God. Make me a pillar in your house. Our general overseer said he was praying that he does not want to be an ordinary Christian. I don't know about you. I don't want to be an ordinary Christian. I want to be a Christian that the Lord God Almighty is using. Father, Lord, make me a pillar in your house. In the name of Jesus, let me not be among the numbers. Father, make me a pillar in your temple. In the name of Jesus, let me not come, oh God, and just be counted among the crowd as one of the numbers that is occupying the seat. Father, make me a pillar in your house. Bring forth, O God Almighty, the gifts inside of me. Father, Lord, stir up the gifts inside of me, O God, that I will be a pillar in your temple. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Mark chapter 7, verse 24. Mark chapter 7, verse 24 says, then came together unto him. Mark chapter 7, verse 24, please. Verse 24. And from thence he arose and went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon, and entered into an house, and would have no man know it, but he could not be hid. Jesus could not be hid. Brethren, when you are carrying Jesus inside of you, you cannot be hid. The word of God says that in Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, that we are light and we are a city placed on a hill that cannot be hidden. Please bring it up. Matthew chapter 5, verse 14. It says, ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. We are going to cry to God this morning that, Lord God Almighty, as I carry Jesus inside my life, let my glory shine. This morning, to confirm that this is what the Lord wants me to pray about, as I saw one of my mommies in the choir, she's over 70 and she's singing and her glory is radiating in the house of God. The person who led the choir this morning, some time back the enemy wanted to kill her. As she's standing, I'm happy that she can stand up because the enemy wanted to take her legs up. And so many of us, there is one thing about us that God has given us overcoming victory. We are going to pray this morning that, Father, Lord God Almighty, let my glory come forth. Let my glory shine up. Let my glory shine. Let my glory radiate up. Let the enemy not cover my glory. Let them not cover the glory of the children that you gave me. Let them not cover the glory of my spouse. Let my glory shine up. I am a city placed on a hill. Brethren, when somebody's glory cannot come out, that person becomes an handicap. Father, Lord, there are people who have read PhD and their brains are not working now. Father, Lord God Almighty, let my glory shine. Let me be, oh God, a city that cannot be hidden. Let me, oh God Almighty, let the Jesus inside of me, let it come out. In the name of Jesus, let Jesus radiate in my life. Let my glory not be covered up. Let my glory not be tampered with up. Let the cloud of the satanic clouds up, evil cloud, let them not cover my glory. Let my star shine up. Let my light come forth up. Let my light not go dim up. In the name of Jesus, let my glory come forth up. Wherever I go, let me carry Jesus up. When you are carrying Jesus, when you get to your office, they will know that you are carrying Jesus up. Father, Lord God Almighty, let my glory shine up. Let my glory come forth up. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. As I'm rounding up, I'll just take 1 or 2 minutes. Please permit me. Our pastor has been telling us about Samson. That's what he was telling us this morning. Samson was making a spot in the house of the enemy. That is, he was dancing for the enemy. You are here in the house of God. You will not dance for the enemy. They will not carry, you will not dance for idols. You are dancing for Jesus. You will no longer dance for the enemy. You will not dance in the house of the idol. You will not come to a situation whereby they will tell you to come and try another thing. To come and try. In fact, I want you to pray this morning. Father, Lord God Almighty, in the name of Jesus, I am dancing in the house of the Lord. I will not make a spot for the enemy. In the name of Jesus, I will not dance for the enemy. Nothing, oh God Almighty, the Bible says the one that has put his hand into the plant and he looks back is not fit. Father, Lord God Almighty, oh God, help me, oh God. Let me not go back. In the name of Jesus, I will not dance for the enemy. I will not dance for idols. In the name of Jesus.
Welcome to a glorious day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice in it, and it shall gladden our hearts. This week, we celebrated International Women's Day on Thursday, 8th of March. This is an annual event, and this year's theme for International Women's Day was Press for Progress. And I pray that even as the Lord remains the wind behind our sail, that we will continue to press for progress toward the mark for the prize. The theme of our service today is purpose-driven exploits. Indeed, we need to live our lives very purposefully so that God will bless the works of our hands and that we'll continue to do great and mighty exploits in Jesus' mighty name. I know there'll be a formal introduction later of the minister who will be sharing the word today, but I must acknowledge my sister and my childhood friend, Pastor Mrs. Tomi Shomefu. I want to especially welcome Pastor Shomefu here. I know that we're blessed by the word that God has given her to share with us today. Pastor Tomi, I love you very much. Welcome to our church. I would also like to thank my sisters, Her Majesty's daughters, for their efforts, the resources, the time, the rehearsal to put today's service together. May the Lord richly reward you for your efforts. And may he continue to bless and prosper you in Jesus' mighty name. Finally, I'd like to thank the pastorate of the church, my dear husband, Pastor Ayo Adishola, Pastor Lanrioke, and all the other pastors for the privilege of allowing Her Majesty's daughters to host today's service. We have a few surprises in store for you. So, my dear brothers and sisters in the congregation, I ask you to please sit back, relax, and soak up the spirit-charged atmosphere that I know that today's service is going to bring to you. I love you all, and God bless you. Bye.
We thank God for that message from our mommy, Mrs. Adeshola. I'm sure she's here with us in spirit and praying for us as we go along in this service. We thank God for her leadership of the women in this church. As we take our testimonies, let's turn our Bible to Luke chapter 17. from verse 12. Those of us who have testimonies, let us come forward. For saving of time, I will just tell us what happened here. From verse 12 up to verse 17, we see the healing of 10 lepers. And when 10 lepers were healed, one came back when he saw that he had been cleansed by Jesus to give thanks and to show himself to our Lord. And Jesus asked the question, were there not 10 healed? Why is it only this foreigner that has come back to return thanks? Amen. And he said, go on your way. Your faith has made you whole. Which means that leper was not only cleansed, he was made whole in several other aspects of his life. Are there any one of us that want to return thanks this morning to our Lord and our Father? Please indicate by raising your hand. Any one of us that wants to encourage the rest of us sitting here? Amen. I want to say, without fear of contradiction, that we are all testifiers here today. The mere fact that you are a living soul, can I see your hands raised up, saying, we testify, Father, Lord, we thank you that we are alive today. I don't see any oxygen tanks in the house, which means we are breathing of our own self. I don't know how many of you have had cause to buy an oxygen tank before. You will know that breathing by yourself is by the grace and mercy and the favor of God. Amen. May God give us the grace so that we continue to remain living souls, healthy souls, and always returning thanks and glory unto his holy name. There's a testimony. Please come forward, my sister. Amen.
I thank God because he's God. I worship him because there's no one like him. I thank him because he's awesome, mighty, powerful, wonderful, great. In fact, I don't know how to qualify my God. It's so much. I thank God because this week that passed on marks my second son, 11th year. I thank God because he's not unwitching. I thank God because he's not dead. I thank God because he's not, oh God, you are too much. And that day was the day I gave back to him. It was Sunday. I worship his name because he's God. I thank God because this last week, God gave him and the whole family birthday gift. I have nothing to celebrate it, but I told God, celebrate this boy, Lord. Last Tuesday, I was called from the office that they are burning bushes. I stopped everything I was doing. I was confused. Before then, God has honored us. He has given us an accommodation. I came to it by faith that that place is ours. Even the morning, I could not find money. I could not do anything. But I said, God, the owner of this house will take us as we are. And immediately when the event started, I called her. I said, Mommy, please. I don't know what to do, but this is the situation on ground. She said, please pack yourself, your children, your things, and come over without paying dime. I give him all praise because he's God. I worship him because there's no one like him. And I pray that I will serve him for the rest of my life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And I use this opportunity to pray for as many that are in that shoe. That as the Lord God Almighty has answered me and honor himself in my life, he will honor everybody and will take us out of obscurity into our limelight in Jesus' name. Indeed, this is Canaan land. When I came here, I was naked, but the God of Canaan covered me. I was homeless. The God of Ephesians 7 gave me a home. I was nobody, but he took me to become somebody. Enough. On Thursday, I told God, I said, God, I don't want this woman to chase us out. Do something, God. I called on God, and from nowhere, somebody gave us something that on the road I prostrated. People were like, is she mad? I said, I'm not mad. I prostrated on the express and I rolled for God. And immediately, I forward the money to the mother. I said, Mommy, please, this is a token. We will pay the rest. I just thank him because he's God. There's no one like him. I don't know how to praise him, but I will say thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I want to thank God this morning for the salvation of my life. I want to thank God also for making I and my family to live today that I'm living. I want to thank you for his protection and his guiding. On February 6th, the Almighty God do what he alone can do in my life. I say his name be exalted forever in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Let us lift up our hands and pray for our sisters that as they have indeed returned thanks and glory to God, that which he has started in their lives, he shall perfect it. And that these testimonies shall not become void, they shall not become a snare for them, but rather God's name shall continue to be glorified. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Go forward and be blessed, my sisters. God bless you. Those of us that have our tithes in the house, please come forward. We're all praying for open heavens. However, there are some keys, biblical keys in the Word of God that tells us how to open the heavens. If you go to Malachi 3:10, it tells us, bring all the tithes, the whole tenth of your income into the storehouse, that there may be found food in my house, and prove me now by it, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Open heavens, windows in heaven opened, by the tithes in your hand, come forward with your tithes, a tenth of your income, that the Lord, who has called you to test him in this, will show himself mighty on your behalf. Father Lord, we thank you for your children that has come forward with a tenth of their income. They have come forward to honor you. They have come forward to obey you. We pray that even as they have come with hearts of obedience, Heavenly Father, you shall honor your word in their lives in Jesus' name. That their tithe shall not fall on barren ground, but as they sow this seed, Heavenly Father, it shall bring forth a bountiful harvest in Jesus' name. That those of them who have brought forth, O Lord, you shall rebuke the devourer for their sake in Jesus' name. That, O Lord, indeed, you shall not allow the locust and the cankerworm to visit them and devour their income, but rather you shall continue to prosper the works of their hand and lift them up in Jesus' name. For those of us that have not yet brought our tithe, Father Lord, for those who have, we pray for the heart to understand your word and bring forth. And for those who do not have, Father Lord, we pray for helpers of their destinies. We pray for helpers to open doors unto them so that indeed they may be able to earn a source of living and come back to honor and glorify you. In Jesus' precious name, we have prayed with thanksgiving. Please drop your tithes. We will now take announcements.
Canaan News. this morning we're having a special program being organized by the women of the church. The theme for this program is a purpose-driven exploit. And as I said, it's been organized by the women. I know when women do things, they do it really excellently. My name is Fadeke Adepeto, and I'm not alone here this morning to read the news. With me is
Ngozi Richard Pony. Is this your first time in Canaan land? You're highly welcome. We're so glad to have you. We want you to sit back, relax, and enjoy a beautiful time in God's presence. Now, our services are as follows. On Sundays at 8 a.m., we start with Sunday school. It's a time to look deep into the Word, in Bible study, and discuss with fellow classmates. At 9 a.m., we start our family service, which runs through to 11:30 a.m. Every Tuesday, we dig deep into the Word in Bible study from 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. And on Thursdays, we have a one-hour prayer service, Looking Unto Jesus, which lasts from 6:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. Are you troubled, in need of counsel or advice? We have counselors on ground every day of the week. And if you're interested, please see any of the ushers for assistance. The Lord bless you as you do so. We also have a house fellowship centers scattered around, and you could check the notice board for a center closest to you. Our house fellowships start from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. every Sunday. You can also follow us on our website, www.rccgcanaanland.org. Our YouTube, Facebook accounts are also RCCG Canaanland. Please feel free to explore as you do so in Jesus' name.
So, God, with all these things available, why would anyone want to go to another church? This is a place to be. This is the place where God is. So if you're visiting, make it your church.
You've said it all.
Now, the men of conviction, which is the men's fellowship of this church, they're having a special program at UPDC Estate on the 24th of March. It's for men in the church who are above the age of 30. We're not going to ask for an ID card to make sure that you qualify to be a member of this group. Now, they have also said that they'll be watching the England-Holland match. But because my question is, when men watch a match, I mean at home, when my husband's watching a match, I can hardly speak to him. I don't understand how they want to do this program, the meeting, and the match.
I'm sure they're going to have a referee even as they're watching that match to control our men, you know, well, so much.
The meeting is supposed to be between 5:30 and 7 o'clock, and the host is Mr. Dosumo and other leaders of the industry. If a man over 30 is in this church, you don't want to miss it. You don't want to miss the match, you don't want to miss the food, I don't want to miss the program. So, be there.
Wow, I wish they could invite us, you know, to hang around somewhere.
Should we go and serve?
Maybe, I think we should have small chops.
Yeah, we'll be there.
Yes, we'll be there. On Sunday, the 18th of March, we will be having a special program here, and Dr. Temitope will be with us to see us through a fertility talk. It promises to be an eye-opener. Please ensure you don't miss it. Invite family, invite your friends, and the Lord will reveal great secrets to us in Jesus' name.
Hang my head from sorrow. Yes.
another time for serious empowerment, the second edition of the Lagos Province 67 Empowerment Program is already on course. Funds are available for 3,000 Naira to learn various crafts and skills that will empower you for a lifetime. This empowerment program will start from the 19th to the 24th of March 2018 at RCCG City of Life Parish, 120 Emmanuel High Street, Ogudu, Lagos. As a parish, Canaan Land will be sponsoring up to 20 participants for this program. If you are interested in learning hair gilitying, makeup, bead making, hat making, photography, and all other kinds, please feel free to see us at the church office for registration. The Lord bless you and empower you as you sign up in Jesus' name.
Because I'm definitely going to sign up for the giddy time. What about you?
Wow, I'll be your first customer.
That's good. Now, Kenanath Parish has agreed with a National Identity Management Company, NIMSI, to come here on Sunday, March 18th. They're going to have 10 points for registration. It's extremely important that you register for this program, because without the NIMSI card, you cannot get a passport. It's going to be the general identification method in Nigeria. So everybody has to register. And the church has made it easy, very easy for you. They're bringing the company here. It's going to be 10 points when it's registered, so there will be long queues. So if you haven't got your card yet, this is the opportunity. You must get the card. You must come on Sunday, March 18th. You must register. So we will be expecting.
Wow, it's another hangout time for the youth and young adults. This time around, the Youth and the Young Adults Fellowship is inviting all youth and young adults. I'm sure I'm one of them, of course. Yeah. Inviting us out to a private hangout at Oniru Beach on Saturday, the 24th of March, 2018, at 9 a.m. prompt. The fee is 2,000 Naira only per person, and it's going to be a great time hanging out in the presence of God and your friends.
Like in the hangout.
Yes, indeed. There is a vacancy for the role of a professional driver available in RCCG Canaan Land. So if you have a valid driver's license and have a good knowledge of Lagos road networks, please feel free to apply in the church office. God bless you as you do so.
Great. This morning, we want to specially welcome our guest minister, Pastor Mrs. Tomi Shumefu. Mrs. Shumefu, you're welcome this morning. We're so glad you're in our midst. We're expectant, and we trust that the Almighty God is going to speak through you. I'm particularly expectant, and you know why. Have you enjoyed today's news? Well, you can always watch news again on Canaan New Media TV on YouTube. Can see today's news and also watch the ones from previous months. Until we come again next week.
Are we coming back here next week to cast the news?
Not sure. My name is Fadike Adebatun.
And I'm Ngozi Richard Uponi.
Thank
Bye
you.
Bye for now.
God bless you.
It's offering time. Please package your offering for God. And I would like to also remember that when we come to the presence of God to offer our offering, we should come with a willing heart and give according to our ability. And I'd like you to share this scripture with you. If you go to the book of Exodus, chapter 25, verses 1 to 2. Exodus 25, 1 to 2. God was speaking to Moses, and he said, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, that they bring me an offering of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart, ye shall take my offering." So it's when we bring our offering willingly to God, it is acceptable to him. And also, when Moses wanted to build the tabernacle for God, he called all the children of Israel and told them what the things that were needed for the building of the tabernacle. And this was what now happened after that. Also in the book of Exodus chapter 35 verse 21, and they came everyone whose heart has stirred him up, and everyone whom his spirit made willing, and they brought the Lord's offering to the work of the tabernacle of the congregation and for all his service and for the holy garments. So please let us bring our offering willingly and also according to our ability. In the book of Luke, chapter 21, verses 1 to 4, when Jesus was with the disciples and he was watching people who were giving their offering in the temple, he told his disciples, after observing all the people there, that the widow gave just 2 pennies, and according to, we all know the story, but Jesus said, for all these have of their abundance cast in unto the offerings of God, but she of her penury had cast in all the living that she had, and that was acceptable to God. So please, you do not have to wait until when you become rich or you think you need to give a certain amount of money to God. Whatever you give to God is acceptable to him, because it will be blessed by him and it will increase you. So please, can we put our offerings together as the choir leads us in the congregational hymn?
Good morning, church. Good morning, church. The congregational hymn today is Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Guide me, O Thou Great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but Thou art mighty. Hold me with Your powerful hand. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, feed me now and evermore. Feed me now and evermore.
Please be seated. God is doing wonderful things in our midst, and our brother is bringing us a sister into the church. So I would like to call on Brother Godsent Ezewele and his fiancée, Sister Courage Ann, who are getting married, so that we can present them to the church. Brother Godsent Ezewele and Courage Ann. I'd like to call on our senior pastor, Pastor Ayo Adeshola, to please pray for them.
Can we stretch out our hands towards them? Heavenly Father, we commit this month into your hands, O Lord. Before they were formed in their respective mother's wombs, you had called them, you had set a date aside for them to meet each other, and you had decided that they would become one in holy matrimony, O Lord. My Father, my Lord, even as the day approaches, we pray that your presence will be with them. We pray that you will guide them, pray that you would lead them. Father, Lord, we pray that you would help them to deal with whatever areas of their life may serve as mountains even to the progress of their relationship together, the progress of their marriage, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father in heaven, we pray that even as the day approaches, Father in heaven, everything that they would need in order to make it a glorious event, and more importantly, everything that they would need in order to have a fruitful, meaningful marriage, you release upon them in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father in heaven. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Good morning, church. This morning we have a special number. But before we do so, I'd like to introduce to you this special choir. I'm sure that you think that it's all part of is a church choir. No, it is not. This choir is called His Majesty's Choir. And it's made up of the women in church. This is our first outing. You'll probably see more of us this year. The songs we're going to sing this morning, the two songs we're going to sing, they're all old songs. But this is a 2018 edition. It's a limited edition, the version of the song. So sit back and enjoy.
We wanted to smile, smile, just smile this morning. Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
It's a happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, it's a very, very happy day.
Oh, happy day.
It's a happy, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus was.
When Jesus was.
Oh, when He was.
When Jesus was.
He washed my sins away.
Rejoicing and live rejoicing.
to watch.
Watch and pray.
Watch and pray.
Watch and pray.
And live rejoicing.
And live rejoicing.
Rejoicing. Yeah.
Alagbada ina o alawo tele o atere kari aye oba to fi mole bora bi aso ogbamu gbamu ti o se gbamu oyi biri pojo kuda agbani lagbatan en tin je kawo obirin lo sile bowo a ma njade pelu erin pelu omo ogo ni folorun loki orun olorun ni e ko gbodo ni olorun miran pelu mi e ko gbodo ya erekere fun ara yin tabi aworan nkan ti be loke orun tabi aworan nkan ti be ni salele e gbodo dari ba fun won olorun orun o se
Sunday is special Sunday for women. Wow, 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 wow. That was a beautiful one from the His Majesty's choir. Hallelujah. I'm sure you're beginning to wonder. This Sunday is truly special. We call it a special Sunday service for the women. We had one last year, and of course, God is making it bigger this year. I'd like to introduce a very special group. You know, we always have something special. Last year, we had the Off Steppers. And this year, we are having the Oriki group. And I'm sure you're going to be blessed. They're not coming here to entertain. You know, the Bible says that let everything that has breath praise the Lord. This morning, they're going to give a special kind of praise to the Lord. And I'd like you to just sit down, relax, and be blessed. Your Riku group, please.
Kampi esio, osana o, ey Jesu Christi, opa iku. Kampi esio, osana o, ey Jesu Christi, opa iku. Ebega,
ebega,
ebega, ebega,
ey Jesu o.
Ọmọ Ọlọ́run ẹ̀yin Jésù Kristi ọba ẹgbẹ́ga
ẹgbẹ́ga
ẹgbẹ́ga ọba ẹ̀yin Jésù ọmọ Ọlọ́run ẹ̀yin Jésù Kristi ọba ikú Hosanna o ẹ̀yin Jésù Kristi ọba ikú dẹ́gẹ́ yìí Jésù ará mi o ẹ̀yin Jésù Kristi ọba ikú ẹgbẹ́ga
ẹgbẹ́ga
ọmọ Ọlọ́run ẹ̀yin Jésù o ẹ̀yin Jésù Kristi ọba ọba tó fìdí ayé sọlẹ̀ o
ẹrù rẹ ń bà mí
ẹrù rẹ ń bà mí
ẹrù rẹ ń bà mí o
ẹrù rẹ ń bà mí ọba tó fìdí ayé sọlẹ̀ o
ẹrù rẹ ń bà mí
ọba tó fìdí ayé sọlẹ̀ o
ẹrù rẹ ń bà mí
àfiwá ló lè ṣe.
Ẹrù rẹ ń bà mí.
Àṣẹ kábíyèsí.
Àṣẹ kábíyèsí.
Àṣẹ kábíyèsí.
Kábíyèsí.
Bọ́ba tó fìdí ayé sọlẹ̀ o.
Àṣẹ kábíyèsí.
Bọ́ba tó fìdí ayé sọlẹ̀ o.
Àṣẹ kábíyèsí.
Àṣẹ kábíyèsí.
Àṣẹ kábíyèsí.
Àwúwo má ṣe gbé ọba tó wúwo jàdé ẹlẹ́gẹ̀ alágbádá iná aláwọ̀ tẹ́lẹ̀ oòrùn ọba tí ń fọba jẹ ọba tí ń rọba lóye ọgbọ́n nínú ọgbọ́n ìmọ̀ nínú ìmọ̀ òye nínú òye agbára nínú agbára ojúrere nínú ojúrere ọba mi ọkàn kókòkè ẹlẹ́yinjú àánú alábẹ́nú àsáàsì ọlọ́run àwọn ọmọ ogun ọkàn kókòkè àgbàlagbà oyè nígbẹ́nú àgbàlá ìjọ ọlọ́run àwọn ọmọ ogun ọkàn lánàá ọkàn lónìí ọkàn lọ́la ọkàn títí ayé gbogbo òkèlè ràbàtà tí ò ṣe gbé mi fóṣù àtàjẹ́ ọlọ́run àwọn ọmọ ogun àpáńlá tó tòlé ayé rán ó gbẹ́lẹ̀ kárí omi ó gbómi kárí rẹ̀ ọlọ́run àwọn ọmọ ogun ọlọ́run ńlá ó bẹ́bí ńlá ó ṣòwú ńlá ó gbàtẹ́ ńlá ọlọ́run mi ọkọ mi ògo mi ìgbàlà mi ìwàláàyè mi ojúrere mi ẹwà mi ìyanu mi ọlọ́run ńlá ọba tá pẹ́pẹ́pẹ́pẹ́ tí ó jẹ́ nígbà tó jẹ́ ó jẹ́ jẹwé àtẹ̀gbò lọ ọba tá pẹ́ lájò tó já òdílé à ń pè nílé ó já òdílájò ọkàn lánàá ọkàn lónìí ọkàn títí ayé gbogbo ìbàrẹ́ o ọlọ́run mi ọlọ́run ìwà mímọ́ nínú ìwà mímọ́ ọlọ́run òdodo nínú òdodo agbára nínú agbára iyì nínú iyì ayẹyẹ tó akíkì tó ọlọ́run tó rẹpẹtẹ ọlọ́run tó ṣọmọgbọ nínú ohun gbogbo ayé ọgbà ó fi ṣàkóso ìtìsẹ ọrùn ọgbà ó fi ṣètẹ ọlọ́run mi àpàtàlẹ tó ṣọmọgbọ
That when women do things, they do it excellently. Has this not been a powerful service so far? Has it not been a powerful service so far? Well, I want you to be seated this morning and then wait now for the best. This morning, I'd like to introduce to you our guest speaker, Pastor Mrs. Tomi Shomefu. Mrs. Shomefu has been in the banking world for over 30 years. She's currently the MD of Unity Bank Nigeria. She's worked in UBA, she's worked in several other banks. But most importantly, Mrs. Shomefu is a believer. She's a Christian and she's a pastor. She has laid down all those things to serve God. That's her primary assignment. I've known her now for over 30 years. And I know I've seen the epitome of one, humility and generosity in her life. I've been challenged many times about her generosity. But this one, I just want you to just sit back. I don't want to say much. As we bring forward Pastor Mrs. Tomi Shomefo. Don't worry, Bisola, she does not like people carrying her Bible. So don't worry.
Praise the Lord. Let's give a clap offering unto the Lord. To the Lord. The Lord of Lords. The King of Kings. The one who has kept us alive. The creator of the universe. The I am that I am. The redeemer of our souls. The one who woke you up this morning. The one who has provided for you. The one who has clothed you with his loving kindness and tender mercies. Give him a clap offering. Give him the praise that he deserves this morning. Give him all the glory, all the adoration, all majesty, all honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we have worshipped. Please be seated. And I want to greet my brother and my sister, especially this morning. I am a member of this family for many, many reasons. One, I have many friends in this church. I have family in this church. Your pastor's wife, as she said, is a childhood friend. She's actually a distant relative. She forgot to mention that. But we are all related by the blood of Jesus. Amen. And I want to thank you for the privilege of standing before you this morning. I don't know who Pastor Fadeke was introducing, but God bless you, Fadeke. I've been asked to speak this morning on, I must say something about that wonderful choir. That was wow. Pastor Ayo, I hope the choir in the church, the regular choir, will not be challenged by this. But that was wow. And as for that Oriki, it was straight from the throne room. The Lord will increase your anointing in the mighty name of Jesus. And as you have worshipped and praised the Lord, it will be acceptable unto him, a sweet-smelling sacrifice in the mighty name of Jesus. I've been asked to speak this morning on purpose-driven exploits. And the Lord will help me because everything has gone wonderfully well so far. But I know that the expectation of the righteous will not be cut short. In the mighty name of Jesus. Let's rise to our feet. Let's rise to our feet. Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive. To receive glory, honor, and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Thou art worthy, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive all glory, honor, and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. That song is in Revelation chapter 4. Verse 11, it says, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive all glory, all honor, and all power. For you have created all things, including you and I. All things you have created for your pleasure. they are and were created. Let's sing it one more time. Thou art worthy, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive all glory. Worshipped. Please be seated. Genesis chapter 1, I'll read verses 1 and 2, and then I'll read 24 to 31. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 24 to 31. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of waters. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. I'll read now from 24 to 31. Verse 24 says, then God said, let the earth produce every sort of animal, each producing offspring of the same kind, livestock, small animals that scurry along the ground, and wild animals. And that is what happened. God made all sorts of wild animals, livestock, and small animals, each able to produce offspring of the same kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make human beings in our own image to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, all the wild animals on the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground. 27. So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them and said, 28, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and govern it. Reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, and all the animals that scurry along the ground. Then God said, I have given you every seed-bearing plant throughout the earth and all the fruit trees for your food. And I have given every green plant as food for all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, and the small animals that scurry around the ground, and everything that has life. And that is what happened. Verse 31. Then God looked over all that he has made, and he saw that it was very good. God looked over all that he has made, and he saw that it was very good. How many very good things are here? Are you part of God's creation this morning? You can encourage your neighbor and tell them that God thinks you are very good. Say it as if you mean it. You can say that to yourself as well, that God thinks I am very good. This morning we're looking at purpose-driven exploits. And the first question perhaps that you want to ask is, what is purpose? What is purpose? Psalm 19 verse 1 says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims all his handiwork. It means that everything that God created, when he looked at it, he saw that it was good, and everything is pointing to only one thing, God's glory. But let's look at man, because I'm sure that we're not talking of the purpose of animals or in creation in general. What is the purpose of man? Why did God create man? Why? Why did God decide to create man? And if you notice, God created man on the very last day, day six, was when he created man. And after he created man, he rested, meaning that man was what, after he created the moon, the sun, the stars, the fish in the sea, every other thing, the thing that he needed to complete his work on earth, the creative work on earth, was what? Man. And as they say, God reserves the best till the last. So it means that as he created us on the last day, what does that mean? It means that we are the best and the highest in creation. And when he created man, he looked at everything and said, it was good. Isaiah 43:7, God said, everyone that is called by my name, I have created you for my glory. So you can look at the purpose of man generally. The purpose of man in general was to give glory, is actually to give glory to God and to dominate the earth that God has created. Are we still together this morning? All of creation has a purpose, as I said. The general purpose of creation is to declare God's glory. So what is purpose? What is purpose? Because I think, you know, I'm an English, my first degree was in English. So I like to break things down by looking at the literary meaning, because then it will lead us to the spiritual meaning. What is purpose? Purpose in simple English is the reason something was created. Purpose is the reason something exists. The purpose of a chair is to provide rest for human beings. You sit on a chair. Am I correct? The purpose of this microphone is to amplify or project the voice of the speaker. So purpose is the reason something was created. By implication, that means that there was a need. There's a reason. There was a void somewhere. And that is the reason for creating that particular thing. And if you look at Genesis chapter 1, the Bible tells us that when God looked at the earth, he saw that it was without form. It didn't make any sense. It was void. There was no structure. There was no order. He then looked at it and began to put order, structure, one after the other, until he got to man. So first thing we see there is that God is a God of purpose, he's a God of plan, and he's a God of order. He doesn't do anything by accident. There's a reason for everything he created. And I want to encourage us to go back to Genesis 1 and read it again. God explained what he was doing. He said, let us create this to be there. Let us create that to do this. He had a reason for creating every single thing that he made. And that includes man. There's a reason for creating man. But purpose of man, as we said, is to dominate God's creation and to give God glory. The song that we sang said, he has created all things to bring him pleasure. But within that global purpose, within the general purpose, within the general reason that God created man, which is to give him glory, there is a specific purpose for every single individual. Are you here with me this morning? There is a specific reason why God created you. There's a specific reason why God created me. The reason I am here is different from your own reason. Why do I say that? No two human beings are alike. Even identical twins. God is so awesome. David said in Psalm 139, he said, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. That means that you are different from the next person. Are you here with me? You are different from the next person. Even identical twins. I don't even know if anybody has identical twins here. Sometimes you mix them up. Sometimes you have identical twins. I'm pastor, I know. The last time I was actually here was during the dedication of the twins, so you can imagine how long that was ago. But even identical twins, sometimes their parents mix them up. But what differentiates them? The thumbprints. Have you ever thought about it, that no two thumbprints are alike? No matter how much you look alike, your thumbprints will always be different. Isn't God awesome? What is that telling you? You are different from the next person. And by implication, your purpose is different from another person's purpose. Yes, we all have a global purpose. I want to stretch it a bit further. That inside the general purpose of man, which is to glorify God, is what we call a calling. And that is your own God-given purpose, your own God-given assignment. And you know, as I was thinking about this, God flashed a picture in my mind. And that is the picture of a jigsaw puzzle. How many of us know what a jigsaw puzzle is? How many of us know what a jigsaw is? A jigsaw puzzle is a puzzle that, you know, children play with, and they cut it. They cut it, and then you're supposed to fit each piece together to make a picture. And you find out that those things are cut with such precision that that piece fits exactly into where the space is. If you try and fix something else, will it fit? No. Our lives are exactly like that. And as individuals, we're exactly like that. Within the global picture or the global purpose, there is a missing piece that only you can fill. There's a missing piece that only I can fill. And that is what you will call a calling. I'm going somewhere. You can look at, because today is Women's Day, and by the way, congratulations to all the mothers and all the women in the house. If you don't have children yet, you are still a mother because you are nurturing something. Amen? So you are a mother in your own right. Look at our kitchen. You have different utensils in the kitchen. You have the spoon, the knife, the measuring cup, the rolling pin for those who bake. You have all manner of things. What is the purpose of all those things? All of those things are to help you produce a meal. Am I correct? But every single one has its own use. The knife, the use of the knife is different from the use of the spoon. You cannot use a knife to turn soup. I'm sure some of our men have tried it when they try to cook, but it doesn't work, does it? The purpose of, or the use of a spoon is different from the use of a knife. And that is how different we are in our different calls or our different purposes for God. So how do we discover our purpose? First of all, let's see, why is it important to know the purpose of a thing? Or why is it important to know your own purpose? The first reason is because Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5 encourages us that before God knew us, before God created us, he had something in mind. That is why it was that particular sperm from your mother that fertilized that particular egg that your mother released. Sorry, your sperm from your father that fertilized the particular egg your mother released. Any other combination would have produced a different result, even from the same parents. Do you get that? So God had a particular thing in mind when he created us. That's the first thing. Second thing is that if we don't understand the reason we are here, if you don't understand the use of a thing, what happens? You abuse it. You abuse it. If you don't understand the reason something was made or something was created or the reason something exists, then you abuse it. Therefore, if you don't understand your purpose or your calling in life, and I'm talking particularly to the younger people. Some of us are in our second half, so God will have mercy on us. Amen? But for the younger ones that are still coming up, it's important that you understand and recognize why you are here. It is so crucial. If you understand why you exist, if you understand that God has a specific reason when he created you, then you will make fewer mistakes. Amen? You will make fewer mistakes. If you don't understand the purpose of a thing, you will abuse it. If you don't understand your reason for being here, God forbid that our lives will be a waste. The second reason we need to understand our purpose is because if you don't understand the purpose of a thing, you cannot optimize the use. You cannot use it effectively. A lot of us are operating below capacity. A lot of us are operating we're just going through the motions. A lot of us are doing that, even especially as adults, because we do not understand the purpose for which we are here. Or even if we understand that there's a reason we're here, we don't understand the magnitude of the purpose God has for our lives. So another reason why you need to understand or define or identify your purpose or your specific calling is so that you will optimize its use. And just to help us this morning, I want to look at some of the people that had purpose in the Bible and did exploits. You cannot do exploits if you do not understand your purpose. As a matter of fact, you can only do exploits within the purpose that God has given to you. And I want to look at some examples this morning. The whole of the Bible talks about exploits from A to Z. From Genesis to Revelation, it talks about different exploits of different men of God and those who were not men of God. There were some that performed negative exploits. We heard about Samson this morning. He did some good exploits and he did some bad exploits. It's all about purpose. There is Moses that had a purpose. His purpose was to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt and into the promised land. But did he fulfill his purpose? Did Moses complete his purpose? Did he complete it? No. We'll look at the reason he did not complete it later on. But the first example I want to pick is Peter. And you look at the story of Peter in Luke chapter 5. I think for want of time, I will not read the whole scripture. But let's look at the story of Peter. Peter was a fisherman. He was fishing. And he must have been a very good fisherman for him to be, you know, on the sea when Jesus came. He must have been. That was his daily job. That was his vocation. That was what he was used to doing. And he must have been very good at it. Why did I say he was good at it? When Jesus came to tell him that, look, cast your net into the sea, what did he say? He said, we have toiled all night. He was an expert at what he was doing. That was his daily job. Peter, however, at the end of that story, if you look at Luke chapter 5, verse 1 to 5, I believe, Jesus told him something. He said, you have been fishing for fish, but now I will make you what? Fishers of men. What did he say? He abandoned his boat and followed Jesus. Why would he abandon something that he was good at? Was Peter meant to be a fisherman? Was that his purpose in life? Was that his calling? The work of a fisherman was merely what I will call an assignment, which brings me to the third terminology. We've talked about purpose, calling, and we're talking now about assignment. What is an assignment? An assignment is a task that you do within your calling or your purpose. But the first mistake a lot of us make is that we hold on to that assignment as if it was the purpose or the reason that we are here. I'm going to take that again. We hold on to assignments that God gives to us as if that is why we are here. For example, I work as a bank official. Is that my calling in life? No, it's not my calling in life. Is that the purpose for my existence? No, it's not the purpose of my existence. It's only an assignment. And why is it important for us to differentiate between an assignment and a purpose? If you don't know the difference, then you hold on to that assignment and forget your purpose in life. That will not be our portion in Jesus' name. Because today is Mother's Day, I want to talk about That as it regards our women. We worry, slave, we pour our lives into our husbands, into our children, as if our very lives depend on it. It's good. But I want to dislodge your thinking this morning. That is only an assignment. It is not your purpose or your calling in life. Your calling in life is not to be a good mother or a good wife or a good whatever it is. Your calling in life is to do that which God has placed in your hands to do. Your work as a mother and a wife is an assignment. Apologies to all the men in the house, but it's only an assignment. It's a platform that God has given you to express yourself and to fulfill your calling. And we can see this in what Peter did. When Peter abandoned the work of fishing, what happened to him? Look at the exploits that he did. Acts chapter 3, verse 6. He healed a lame man. Acts chapter 5, verse 15. His shadow started healing the sick. Acts chapter 2, 41. He preached a sermon. 3,000 people were saved. Acts chapter 4, verse 4. He preached another sermon. 5,000 people were saved. Is this the same Peter that was fishing when Jesus saw him? Is this the same Peter? Is it the same Peter? No. It's not the same Peter. That Peter was on an assignment. He was a fisherman. But when he left everything, Jesus said, I will make you a fisher of men. And he recognized that immediately and saw that his purpose or his calling in life was not his vocation as a fisherman, but as a fisher of men, or an apostle or evangelist or whatever it is you choose to call him. May God help us to separate our daily assignments from our purpose or calling in life, in Jesus' name. The second person I want to look at, and perhaps this is more interesting, is Joseph. And I want to point out a few things about purpose and calling concerning. Did Peter do exploits or not? Did he do exploits or not? He did exploits within his purpose. Look at the story of Joseph. And for every young person here, I encourage you to go and read the story of Joseph. There are so many lessons to learn there. Every time I read that story, I get something new, because it's a testimony of what God can do in the life of someone whom he has given a purpose to. What can we say was Joseph's purpose in life? What was his purpose? What was his purpose? We'll get there. I thought somebody would help me. But let's look at how Joseph started. I'm going to summarize that whole story because we just want to take a few points from there. Joseph was a favorite of his parents, of his father especially. He was a favorite. And from the time he was 17, God showed him a lot of favor. And he never really went out into the field with his brothers. He was always at home, and they would send him to look after his brothers. Along the line, God gave him a dream. He dreamt of greatness. I'm sure you all know that story. He dreamt that the sun, the moon, and the stars were all bowing before him. He dreamt that there were sheaves of corn, and all his brothers' sheaves bowed down to him. What can we take away from here? Sometimes God will reveal your purpose to you in a dream. Sometimes God will reveal the reason you are here or the exploits he wants to do through you in a dream. Joseph was young. He didn't understand it, but God was already preparing him. God was already telling him, giving him an advance notice of the exploit he was going to do through him. What was it that Joseph did? He got up and shared the dream with his brothers. Young people, and even some of us old people, when God has placed a task or a calling in your heart, don't share it prematurely. What did I say? Don't share it prematurely because of dream killers. Joseph was excited. Perhaps there was a bit of pride. And it was only by the mercy of God that he eventually fulfilled his purpose. He knew God showed him what he was doing. God showed him what was going to happen. But he shared it among his brothers prematurely, perhaps out of pride. One thing that will prevent or that may prevent us from achieving our purpose is pride. Pastor Ayo shared that with us in the vestry this morning, that Moses, because of pride, did not achieve his purpose. Because of anger, he did not achieve his purpose. God took him only halfway and then replaced him with someone else. We will not be replaced in the mighty name of Jesus. Genesis 37 verse 14. He went to check on his brothers and what happened to him. His brothers kidnapped him and sold him into slavery. And, you know, when I read this story, I just looked at, I focused and reflected on the awesomeness of God. You know, when God has a plan for your life, when God has a purpose, when you're on it, when you have a calling, the devil can try, but they can never cut you short. Amen. They can only try. They can never cut you short. They may prolong the journey. They may make you go round and round in circles. But at the end of the day, you will reach your destination in the mighty name of Jesus. Joseph was destined for greatness. God had already told him that he was taking him somewhere. What happened? His brothers, because they wanted to kill that dream, because they wanted to make sure that it didn't come to pass, they sold him to some Midianites. The Midianites sold him to who? Potiphar. But if you look at that scripture in Genesis 39, verses 35 to the end, if you read it, what happened? Even in Potiphar's house, Joseph was still fulfilling his call. Did you notice that? Joseph was made head, even as a slave in Potiphar's house. He was put as head over all of Potiphar's belongings and everything that he was doing. What does that tell us? There may be a delay. You may be in the wilderness. You may be not where you want to be. But even where you are, you can still continue to fulfill the call of God on your life, just as Joseph did. And then what happened? God caused a disruption. Why? Joseph's tenure in Potiphar's life or in Potiphar's house was not where God was taking him. It was just an assignment. But perhaps God saw that Joseph was becoming very comfortable. After all, he was the chief slave or whatever it was that he was. And everything was okay. He had access to everything. He didn't lack anything. What happened? God brought in a disruption. Somebody say disruption. God used Potiphar's wife to cause unsettlement in Joseph's life. Just as when God will use some things to shake us up, when he sees that we are getting too comfortable with an assignment and we are missing his ultimate purpose, or we're missing the ultimate thing that he has destined for us, he will cause some things to shake just to make us uncomfortable. But everything is working towards where he's taking us. Amen. What happened? Potiphar's wife took a fancy to Joseph, began to entice her, and you know the rest of the story. Joseph found himself in prison. Obviously, he would have looked at it that, my goodness, what is all this? I had dreams. I had a promise of greatness. I had a promise of great exploits, of a big purpose. How am I fulfilling God's purpose even in prison? But what happened in prison? The Bible tells us that God was with Joseph even in prison. And what happened? Again, he found favor with the warder, and they made him the head of prisoners. What can you say about that? When God has a purpose for your life, wherever you find yourself, you will operate in that purpose. Amen? As long as God is with you, you will operate in that purpose that he has defined for you. And then what happened? God caused, in fact, I like that part very much. You know, sometimes to fulfill his purpose, God will just cause some things to happen to some other people, as he's going to do for someone here this morning. He's going to just make something happen somewhere that only you can solve. Look at the way God did everything. Look at the way he lined it up. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is so awesome. Look at what he did in verse 40. He says, and it came to pass. Sorry, chapter 40, verse 1. And it came to pass after these things that the butler of the king of Egypt and his baker offended their lord, the king of Egypt. Why did they have to offend the king? Why? Because God had a purpose for Joseph's life that the butler and the baker were key to. They were part of that puzzle. So they needed to have offended the king and be sent to prison. See how God organizes everything. Therefore, I have a message for you this morning. Whatever is happening to you, wherever you may find yourself, it's part of the plan. Amen? It's part of the plan. As long as God is with you, it's part of the plan. I like this song very much by Travis Green. It says, it's intentional. All things are working for my good. It's intentional. It's part of the grand plan. It's part of the grand scheme of things. It's part of the plan of God for you to fulfill purpose. So the butler and the baker offended their king. Not only did they offend the king, they came into the prison, and then God caused them to have what? A dream. And look at the coincidence. Look at verse 5. I want you to go and read that scripture when you get home. They dreamt on the same day. What are the odds? They were put in prison on the same day, and they had two different dreams on the same day. Is that coincidence or God? That must have been God. And of course, they came to Joseph to interpret the dream. And Joseph interpreted the dream. Of course, it happened exactly as he said. The baker was killed. The butler went his merry way and promptly forgot about Joseph. He forgot about the person who helped him. Every helper of your destiny that is necessary for you to fulfill your purpose that has forgotten, God will wake them up for you in Jesus' mighty name. Can you imagine? The butler forgot for 2 years. 2 years. Some of us are sitting down. We're looking at it that God has said I will do X, Y, Z. I can see this person. He can help me. Yet, they are not helping me. They are not meant to help you. They are not called to help you. The people that God have called to help you, at the appointed time, in due season, they will not find rest until they help you. And then look at what happened again. See how God works to fulfill purpose and to make sure that Joseph ultimately did the exploits. What happened? He caused Pharaoh to have a dream that no one could interpret. 2 years later, the butler now remembered that, there was somebody. Everybody who has something to give to you that have forgotten, God will give them a holy remembrance in Jesus' name. God will wake them up, and they will not rest until they find you with what they have for you in the mighty name of Jesus. So they called Joseph. And of course, the rest is history. But what I want to point out there is this. Our calling is never far away from the natural gifts God has given to us. How do you discover your purpose? How do you discover your calling? One, the Spirit of God has to reveal it to you. But look around you. What are the gifts? What are the things that God has blessed you with? What are your natural abilities? Look at the first example we gave, Peter. Peter was a fisherman. He was used to throwing his net and catching fish. And then Jesus made a pronouncement that I will make you fishers of men. And then he threw his net of the word of God and he made a multiple catch. The same skills, the same abilities is what God used to push him to do his purpose-driven exploits. Look at Joseph. Joseph was a dreamer. Not only was he a dreamer, he was good at interpreting dreams. And that was what God used to bring him to his purpose and to do exploits. What was the exploit that Joseph was reserved for? What was it? What was the purpose? The purpose that all of this was happening to Joseph. You can see it in Genesis 45. I believe it's Genesis 45. At the end, when eventually he saw his brothers. Genesis 45, I think it's verse 7. Where he said to them that God sent him ahead to preserve their lives. That was Joseph's singular purpose. His singular purpose was to go ahead into Egypt and prepare for the children of Israel to come during the famine. That was his own reason for being alive. That was his own purpose. That was his calling, to be a deliverer, to be a savior of some sort for his people. But look at all the steps he took to get there. Look at the roundabout way that he got there. No matter what it is, as long as we're in Christ, we will always achieve our God-given purpose in Jesus' mighty name. What are some of the things that we can see from the two examples that we gave? The first thing, of course, is that you cannot even begin to talk of purpose if you are not saved. You can't even begin to talk about purpose if you don't know God. You can't. Because if you don't know your Creator, the person who made you, and if you don't have a relationship with Him, then you cannot even begin to think of, okay, why did God create me? Why am I here? Why? What is the reason for my existence? So the first thing is a relationship with God. And it is on the platform of that relationship with God that we can begin to talk about purpose or calling or whatever else that we're talking about. The second thing also is that our purposes are different. And as human beings, we must learn to run our own race. Yes, we are all going towards the same destination. Our purpose is to glorify God and make heaven and fulfill, you know, whatever it is that, and give Him glory. But within that purpose, as I said, each one of us is an individual. Run your own race. We have a tendency as human beings to compare ourselves with others. You cannot really do exploits if you are busy trying to fulfill somebody else's purpose. Are you with me this morning? Are you with me this morning? If you are busy trying to fulfill somebody else's call, or you are busy trying to, you can copy good things in people. Please don't get me wrong. You can copy good things in people. You can make it improve your life. But let's stop comparing ourselves to other people. Somebody is praying in tongues 24/7. you know, you like the way a particular person preaches, they sweat and everything, they are an intercessor. Then you think about it that, oh, I want to be an intercessor. My, is that your calling? Has God placed that in your hands? You like the way a particular person teaches. You like the glamour, you know, when they preach, everything shakes and all that. And you want to be like them. That may not be your calling. Your calling is that thing that is specific to you. That thing that you know that this is my own assignment. A lot of us are called to different things. It may not necessarily be visible. It may not be glamorous. It may not be something that is even obvious to anybody. But the important thing is that wherever you are, be it quietly, be it in a large crusade, you are fulfilling God's purpose for your life. Amen? And you are fulfilling His call upon your life. There are a lot of people who go to the prisons every Sunday. They preach powerfully and people are getting converted. There are people who preach under the bridge. There are people whose call is just to minister to young people and guide them along the way. There are people who preach to millions of people and they'll be saved. Everybody has their own call. Everybody has their own purpose. Everybody is a piece of the jigsaw. And in a jigsaw, no two pieces are the same. So please, run your own race. Don't run another person's race. Amen? The other thing is that you have to cultivate, you have to discover your purpose. You have to discover your calling. Early on in life is good, but you have to be pretty sure about it after a while. The reason I say that is this. If you don't know your calling or your purpose, as I said, you'll be prone to abuse. Any little thing will shake you. But when you know that you know that you know that God has a particular calling, a particular purpose for your life, then you will not be shaken by whatever it is that comes your way. You will know that no, this cannot be the end. This story is, you know, like the series we watch on television, to be continued. You know that it can never be the end. Why? Because you know that there's something at the end of it that God has for you. And you know that you cannot die or you cannot be stopped until you fulfill that assignment that God has, that purpose that God has for you in the mighty name of Jesus. The fourth thing is that we have to be bold. We have to be bold. We have to be strong. Daniel 11:32, it says, they that know their God shall be what? Strong. And then do what? Great exploits. You know, it's not enough to know your purpose. It's not enough to know your calling. You have to be strong. You have to be bold. You have to know that I can take this mountain. I can do this thing. With God, I can do all things. You know, there are some things that God will lay on our hearts. There are some purposes that you know that will even frighten you. And because of fear, you will just stay and be procrastinating and wondering, how can I do this? How can I do that? Be bold. The Bible says, they that know their God shall be strong. After they are strong, they will then do exploits. So how do you do purpose-driven exploits? You need to be bold. You need to be strong. You need to know who you are in God. You need to know what it is. Who, that you are not an ordinary person. You are somebody that is going somewhere. You are somebody that God has deposited a lot in. You are somebody that is unique and different from the next person. You have a God-given task. You have a God-given assignment. And that knowledge will give you boldness to take on anything that God has put in your hands. So you have to know your God. If you don't know your God and who you are in Him, you cannot do any exploits. Perhaps the most important thing is that we need to make our way right with God. You can know your purpose from now till whenever, but if your ways are not right with God, you cannot even do any exploits. First, you need to be saved. Then you need to know what your purpose is. The next is that you need to be bold. But if you don't make your way right with God, then what you will see is negative exploits. Look at Samson, the example that we were given this morning. Samson obviously had a purpose. Samson was, in fact, he had a purpose from his birth. And then what happened? He toyed with sin. And look at the way he ended. Look at Moses, the way he ended. But there are people who started in the wrong way, and along the line, they made their ways right with God, and they fulfilled purpose. Look at Rahab, the harlot. Rahab was a harlot. But did she fulfill purpose or not? She fulfilled purpose. And God saved her and her household as a result of that. So what are we saying this morning? Every one of us has a God-given purpose. Every one of us has a blueprint that God has defined for us on how we will get there. Wherever you are in your journey, just know that it is part of the journey. Romans 8:28 says to us that all things, how many things? All things work together for the good of those who love God and what are called according to His purpose. So whatever it is that may be happening to you now, as long as you are called according to God's purpose, you know that ultimately is working for your good. And then what? You need to be bold. And finally, you need to make our ways right with God. Shall we stand to pray this morning? Let's stand to pray this morning. You know, we said that there's a difference between assignments. There's a difference between purpose and calling. A lot of us are still busy doing different assignments. We are stuck in a rut because we're just going around in circles. Because we don't understand that there's a bigger picture. There's a greater plan. It's not about going to work, being a successful businessman, making a lot of money, being a wonderful wife and mother, or being the best student in your class. That's not your purpose in life. It's not your purpose in life. That's just an assignment. And guess what? Assignments expire. They have a timeline. But the purposes of God stand what? Forever. And when we get to heaven, you know, Revelations, there's a scripture in Revelations that says that people were weeping in heaven. Why would we be weeping in heaven? Why would that? Because God said that Jesus will wipe the tears from our eyes. And I thought about it, that why will we be crying when we get to heaven? I know that when I get to heaven, I'll be very happy that I even made it. So maybe I'll cry tears of joy. Amen. But I don't think it's tears of joy that they were talking about in that scripture. I think the tears are more tears of regret. That yes, we made heaven. Glory be to Jesus. But did we actually fulfill the purpose of God for our lives? I want you to think about it this morning. By the grace of God, we will all make heaven. But when we get to heaven, will He say to you, "Welcome, good and faithful servant"? The only way you will get "Welcome, good and faithful servant" is if you have fulfilled the purpose of God for your life. And if you have done the exploits that God has planned for your life. It's not enough to just exist. It's not enough to just be successful. And what is success at the end of the day? Success is not about what we achieve here on earth or getting to the pinnacle of our career or making a first class in school or being wonderful in everything we do. Success is fulfilling and achieving God's purpose for your life. Success is fulfilling your calling. So this morning you are here today. I would like to pray with several categories of people because I'm sure I'm out of time now. The first is that you don't even know this Jesus we're talking about. If you don't know Jesus or you've never given your life to Christ, then you have not even started. Then your life is like Genesis chapter 1 verse 1. Without form, there was darkness on the face of the earth. That's how your life is right now. If you don't have Jesus, your life is without form. You cannot even begin to talk of purpose or calling. You are just running around. And if you are running around without purpose, anything can happen to you. You are a sitting duck. So this morning, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, that is the place to start. The second category of people is, you know that where you are is not, that's, it's not, there's something more. There's, you know, there will be a hunger in your spirit because you know that, yes, you've done this, you've done that, you're successful, but there's something more. You know that your reason for being here is beyond what you are doing now, but you have not quite discovered that purpose. Only God can help you to discover your purpose. Only God can help you to discover your calling. Some of us have an idea. It's only God that knows everything 100%. But some of us have an idea. And as I said, your calling is never too far away from your God-given abilities or what you are good at. Look at every great preacher. They always have a wonderful voice. Am I correct? Their voice always, you know, projects. They have a way of expressing things. That's why some of us are not preachers. We're just managing ourselves as we are. So you know that there is something, but you don't have it yet. This morning, even as you go home, God will help you to discover your purpose. The third category of people, which is where a lot of us will probably fall into, is yes, you know your calling, you know your purpose, but you are not yet in the realm where you are doing exploits. What is the use of a purpose or a calling if you are not doing exploits for God? The Bible says the path of the just shines brighter and brighter towards a perfect day. Every day of our lives is supposed to be filled with exploits. Jesus, when he was living, said, "Greater works shall you do?" He says, "We will do greater works than what he did." Are you doing in greater works? Are you already operating in the realm of greater works? How many times have you laid hands on the sick and they got well? How many times have you raised the dead? How many times have you preached a sermon and thousands gave their lives? How many times have you done something that heaven itself will say, yes, this person is fulfilling purpose? So first category, you have not been saved. You've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Second category, you are still trying to find the meaning of your life. Third category, you have found purpose. You know what your calling is, but you are not yet operating in the realm of exploits. So even if you are doing exploits, you are not there. I want us to pray this morning. First of all, let's pray that anything in our lives, for those who have not given their lives to Christ, even as all eyes are closed, you can raise up your hand and I'm sure the ushers will, you know, minister to you. Let all eyes be closed, please. If you have never surrendered your life to Jesus, or you know that you have surrendered your life, but there is sin in your life, you cannot even do anything called exploits if there is sin in your life. So you need to raise up your hand And let's settle that matter right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Even as you have raised your hand, the Lord will accept you in his kingdom in the mighty name of Jesus. Or if you know that you have given your life to Christ and there's sin in your life, sin plus exploit is disaster. You need to get right with God. Second category is those of us who are trying to discover our purpose. Or you have discovered it and you are not yet clear on it. And this morning, I want us to pray that the Holy Spirit will reveal himself even unto us. The Bible tells us that as many as are led by the Spirit of God will be called the children of God. We are all children of God. Open your mouth and begin to talk to the Lord this morning that, Father, reveal yourself to me. Reveal to me the reason I am here. Let me not be a waste. Let me not just wander on this earth and not know why I am here. Let me not live my life by trial and error. Help me to hit the target. Help me to know the plan for my life. Help me to know why I was created. Help me not just to be a copycat. Help me to be distinguished. Help me to realize that I am unique. Help me to know that there is a special reason. There's a special reason why you created me. There's a special reason why you placed me on this earth. Help me not to follow the crowd. Reveal to me your plan for my life. Reveal to me your plan for my life. Jacob said, I will not let you go until you bless me. This morning, open your mouth and cry to God that, Father, I am your child. You have a blueprint for my life. You have a purpose for my life. You have a specific call for my life. Help me to discover my calling. Help me to discover why I am here. If I have missed it in any way, and I have chased things that you have not called me to do, help me to retrace my steps. Father, this morning, help me to retrace my steps. From now on, I want to live only in your purpose. I want to live only in your purpose. I want to live only in your purpose. I want to do only the things that you have called me specifically to do. I don't want to follow the crowd. I don't want to be blown by the wind. I want to be guided by your spirit. Let me sleep tonight and begin to speak to me about specific things that I have been created to do. Begin to open my eyes to see what you have called me to do. Let me not live my life just anyhow. Let me not get to heaven and be filled with regrets. Let me not live my life thinking that I am serving you when I'm only serving myself. Father, help me. Help me to fulfill purpose. Help me to fulfill purpose. Next, we are going to pray. The Bible says, they that know their God shall be strong and will do exploits. Let us talk to God and cry out to him and say, Father, I am for signs and wonders. My portion is to do exploits. My portion is to do exploits. My portion is to do greater works. My portion, even where you have placed me, is to do great things for you. Help me to stop operating below my capacity. Help me to maximize my purpose. Help me to maximize the God-given gift you have given to me. Help me to operate in the realm where you have placed me. Help me, help me, help me to do greater works. Help me so that my life will be purposeful. Help me that I will have impact. Help me, oh Lord, so that my life will have meaning. Help me that every day in my life will count for eternity. Help me so that I will have such great strides that even heaven will look down and say, well done, my good and faithful servant. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And finally, if you have any personal prayer points, you know, our prayers get answered and God meets the desires of our hearts when we are fulfilling purpose. You know why? As you are fulfilling God's purposes and doing exploits for him, he's committed to you. Therefore, no evil shall befall you. He's committed to make sure that things work. He's committed to you to make sure that your needs are met. He's committed to make sure that your life goes well. He's committed to you to deliver you out of any evil situation. He's committed to make sure that you are sorted. So why don't you open your mouth and begin to talk to God that, God, even as I have purposed in my heart to fulfill your calling on my life, to discover what it is and pursue what it is that you have created me for, Lord, fulfill my heart's desires. Fulfill my heart's desires. Even as I have promised and purposed to put you first, even as I begin to chase things that matter to you, even as I begin to look to doing exploits for you, come and do that which only you can do in my life. Come and do that which only you can do in my life. Talk to God. Is there a special need? Is there something that is hindering you even from fulfilling your God-given purpose? Is there something that you know that God needs to sort out for you? Is there a reproach in your life that is holding your hands, that is holding your legs? Is there something that is hampering your testimony? Talk to the Lord about this morning. That, Lord, even as I've purposed in my heart to pursue your kingdom agenda, even as I've purposed in my heart that I will do everything for your glory, even as I've purposed in my heart that I will do exploits for you, the ability to do it, give to me. Everything I need, resources, peace, joy, rest, divine health, everything I need to fulfill your purpose, give to me. In the mighty name of Jesus. And it shall be so for us. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Praise the Lord. Please be seated.
Praise the Lord. Let's just pray for Pastor Mrs. Shumefo. Let's thank God for her life. Let's thank God because it is only by God's grace that she stands today. She has given a word concerning our purpose in life, how to find it. And if you don't know it, you need to ask from the Lord. Let us ask that she herself will fulfill purpose in the name of Jesus. Everything that, you know, concerns her, her family, her work, that the Lord God Almighty will prosper her from heaven in the name of Jesus. And even as she has watered today, the Lord himself will water her in the name of Jesus. The Lord will not withhold any good thing from her. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Please bear with us. The service will soon be over. But the service will be incomplete if the women do not have a Thanksgiving dance this morning. All the women in the house, shout hallelujah. If you're here with your friends, your family, your well-wishers, your spouse, you're going to do a Thanksgiving dance. Choir, please. Thank you. We're going to do a Thanksgiving dance from the back to the front. And at the end of that Thanksgiving dance, if you have an offering, you can drop it. Pastor Ayodeshola will be praying for the women in the house. Praise the Lord. From the back, please, let's dance forward. If your spouse is in the house, grab your spouse and dance forward with your spouse.
Have your seat, Baba. Irene, your niche, Iano. Dance, Akire. We praise your name. You are worthy to be praised. Come in your steam, Baba.
We say,
We finish the prayers and we are dancing back to her. Let us really dance. Maybe it's the song that was picked, or maybe the way they sang it, or something. It's just something. But I know as women, we could do a lot better than this. Praise the Lord. You brought your thanksgiving. Can we see the thanksgiving? Ushers, even Jesus Christ himself, he looked at the thanksgiving and see whether it was thanksgiving or not. Let us see the thanksgiving first. Bring it here. Open it. Let's look at it. This is not thanksgiving. This is not thanksgiving. Let us do thanksgiving the way it should be done. If we are thanking God as women in the house, as mothers, as wives, we can do better than this. Praise the Lord. We can do better than this. So please, choir, give us another song. We won't pray yet.
I will lift up your name higher.
Let's do better thanksgiving, please. These baskets are not thanksgiving enough. They are not thanksgiving enough.
Joy overflows.
Father, we thank you for your daughters. We thank you for the great and mighty things you've been doing in their midst. We thank you that as they celebrated, as they had a special Sunday last year, they celebrated in a way the anniversary of the group last year. They are all alive and well even today, O Lord, to also have six similar celebrations. Thank you, Father, Lord, for making them truly your daughters, His Majesty's daughters. I pray, Father in heaven, that they will continue to manifest your majesty. I pray, Father, Lord, that they will continue to manifest your good works. I pray, Father in heaven, especially with the message that has been heard even today, that they will go out and begin to do more exploits for you. In the mighty name of Jesus, my Father, my Lord, these are mothers. These are wives. Mothers to be, wives to be. Father in heaven, we pray that you would bless them and empower each and every one of them in their different endeavors in Jesus' mighty name. Father in heaven, we pray that this year would be unique for them. It would mark the beginning of great and mighty things in their lives in the mighty name of Jesus. As many of them as may be trusting you for the fruit of the womb, Father, let that trust be translated into testimony in the mighty name of Jesus. My Father, my Lord, as many as may be trusting you for future partners, we pray, Father, Lord, that you would answer their prayers even today. In the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Father in heaven, as they have come rejoicing to your altar. We pray, Father, Lord, that the rest of this year and even beyond shall be days of rejoicing for them. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. We bless your name, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
When you see me dance, I dance like a wind of
man.
When you see me dance, I dance like a wind of man.
When you see me dance, I dance like a
wind of man.
When you see me dance, I dance like a wind of man.
Oh, wind of man.
Oh, wind of man.
Oh, wind of man.
Jesus, let's be seated. I pray that sounds of rejoicing will never be far from us in Jesus' name. It's been a wonderful time in the presence of God. We've had an awesome service. We thank God for the message that came forth, and we pray that we'll all testify to great exploits in Jesus' name. I pray that we'll all discover our purpose and our calling in the mighty name of Jesus. It's time for us to cut our cake. Can I please have all the executive forward, please? All the working executives in the Women Fellowship, can you please come forward for the cutting of the cake? Koyo, Mrs. Echo. All right, I would like to take a minute to thank God for every woman represented in the house. I thank the Almighty God for his mercy, his faithfulness, and his protection. And we pray that this time next year we'll all be complete, doing wonderful things in Jesus' name. I humbly request for the presence of Pastor Mrs. Shomefun. Please, can you join us at the table? As well as our pastors, Pastor Ayo and Pastor Lanry. Thank you. Cutting the cake at the sound of the three-letter words HMD, which is an abbreviation of His Majesty's Daughters. So can somebody give me an H? Give me an M. Give me a D. HMD. Photographer. Thank you very much.
Let's give Jesus a clap offering. It's truly been a wonderful service. It's truly been a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful time. Our time is fast spent, but there are three important things I want us to take away from this service very quickly, so that the assignment that Mrs. Shomefun was given is completed fully. Now, when she was rounding up, the Holy Spirit said to me, I am restoring destinies. That's what he said. He said, I am restoring destinies. That's the assignment she came to do, which is to help people who have lost their way find their way back to divine purpose. And there is something instructive she said in her message that I want to leave with you or to remind you of. She said, you can never do exploits outside of your purpose. So the reason many people are living half-measure life is that you are struggling in the wrong place. It doesn't matter how much help you get in that place. You cannot do exploits if you are not in your place of purpose. Therefore, I don't want to even be ceremonial about it. You are here and you heard when Mrs. Shomefun spoke, and you know you have not given your life to Jesus. But when you were coming to church this morning, something said to you that the turnaround, the meaningless turnaround in your life is going to come to an end today. I'm not saying you suggested it. Something said to you when you were dressing this morning that start and stop, that near success syndrome in your life is coming to an end today. I want you to just wave your hand where you are. We are not going to do ceremonies. We are not. If you know that you came to church today, you have not found that purpose, you have not made Jesus your personal Lord and Savior, but something in you said a new phase of life will start today, just wave your hand where you are. Wave your hand where you are. Your new beginning is today. I can see your hand, my brother. Is there anybody else in the house? Today, you know that a new beginning is going to start in your life. Just wave your hand where you are. Wave your hand, because Jesus sent her to perform an assignment on your behalf, and she must not go without seeing that assignment fulfilled. Do we have anybody else? I don't want you to be shy. Okay, everybody close your eyes, if that will make us more comfortable. Close your eyes, bow your heads. If you know you have not made Jesus your Lord and Savior, your Maker is saying, I am restoring destinies today. I'm changing situations around. People who have been struggling for years, that struggle has come to an end. I want you to wave your hand where you are. And you are saying, Jesus, it is time. I want to come out of this start and stop. I want to come out of this near success syndrome. I want to come out of this meaninglessness and aimlessness in my life. If you put your hand up, I want you to stand up where you are this morning. Just stand up where you are and tell Jesus, I am ready. I am ready. I am ready to start a new lease of life. I am ready to come into the purpose that you created me for. Do I still have anybody that we're waiting for? How many of us are standing to make that decree? If you know you are standing, I want you to look towards my brother who is standing by the door. They are waving his hand. And I want you to take your bag. I want you, don't sit down. Don't sit down, my brother. Stand up. Take your bag. Take your Bible and follow my brother at the door there, because we're going to lead you to a place where we will pray with you and your life will never be the same. Let's put our hands together for them, Canaan land. The Holy Spirit said, I am restoring destinies in this place this morning. People who the enemy has dealt with, I am bringing them back to my purpose so that they can begin to live a fulfilling life. God bless you. As you have heeded that call, your lives will never be the same again in Jesus' name. That's the first thing. Now, the second thing is that the Holy Spirit said to me when the women were giving thanksgiving, he said, the destiny of your nation is what you are looking at in front of you there. And to show you what I'm talking about, if Mommy Ademu Agun is here, where is Mom? Because I saw her dancing with the choir. Where is Mommy Ademu Agun? Please come out, ma. Please come out, ma. Who else came to mind? Mommy Disu, please come out, ma. I don't know if Mommy, our octogenarian, I didn't see her in service today. She's not okay. Please come up. I want both of you to come up. Please come up. There are successful men and women who are captains of industry, leaders in this time and generation. These are the people who raised them. These are the people who raised them. These are the people who taught them the values by which they administer thousands and hundreds of men today in the places where they live. And what the Holy Spirit was saying to me, I don't know why he decided to give me a message. He said, value these people standing in front of you, because the destiny of your nation is in their hands. If they teach wickedness, wickedness will overrun the land. How many people know what I'm talking about this morning? If they teach virtue, if they teach patience, if they teach honesty, that is what you will see in the leadership that will emerge in the coming generations in this land. I want us all to say, God bless our mothers and God bless our wives. Thank you, Mas. God bless you. Let's put our hands together for the women in the house. Make sure that you do something to appreciate your mother and or your wife this week. Make sure you do something to say thank you for raising a generation that has led a nation to peace. Many people have tried to trouble the peace of Nigeria, but because of the values that our mothers have instilled, people have found a way to remain in peace. Even as we end the service, we are reminding ourselves that next week, our fertility talk speaker will be here to talk to us about fertility. Now, fertility is not a one member of the relationship thing. It takes two to bring fruit out of a marriage. So it is important that the men don't say next Sunday is the time to watch football match. Come and listen to things that will be of benefit to you or to your children. If you have already produced your children, it will be an interesting time. We have a seasoned medical person coming to talk to us about fertility. Also, the National Identity Management Company will be around to take our details and enroll us for the national identification number. Brethren, it has become critical that you have this number. And Canaan Land has said now that beyond teaching the word, beyond discipling, even things that minister to our lives as individuals within our communities, we will invest in. Now, these forms are available right now with the ushers. If you have not enrolled at a national identity number center, I want you to indicate by lifting your hands now. The ushers will give you this form. You will fill the form. We don't want you to take it out of this auditorium. You will fill it here now. You will return it to us so that the national identity card number people can take it away during the week and prepare your profile. So on Sunday, they are just going to do photo capture and then you can go. Now, you are going to put your BVN number on it. So except you see an usher in a yellow tie or with a yellow flower pinned to the address, don't give it to just anybody. Do you understand me? Make sure you give it to a uniformed usher because we need to protect your information. Please keep your hands up until the ushers have given you the paper, the form, which you have to fill before you leave. Next week, we're going to have about 10 registration centers outside the auditorium. After the lady in charge has spoken to us and after service, we will go outside and register. God bless you in Jesus' name. Now, we want to welcome some special people in our midst. And we want to tell you that you came on a really special day. If today is your first day in Canaan Land, can you just wave your hand? If today is your first day, if today is the first day of worshiping with us, can you wave your hand? If you are waving your hand, can you rise up on your feet where you are? Canaan Land, let's welcome them. Rise to your feet. Rise to your feet. We love you. Thank you for coming. You are answers to our prayers. Canaan Land, shake their hands and welcome them now. God bless you. Thank you for coming. We love you. We know you had many places you could have chosen to worship in. God bless you. Now, don't sit down. Don't sit down. If you are standing, and this is your first time, I also want you to look at my sister by the door there, waving her hand. Just take your bags and your Bibles. We want to meet with you and give you a little reception. Look at her in blue at the door. Let's keep clapping Canaan Land, even as our guest. Just take your bags and Bibles and go with her for a quick reception. God bless you. The rest of us, I'd like us to rise on our feet. Can we rise on our feet? And just do what we usually do as we close the service. I want you to lay hold of the week that is ahead. I want you to decree and declare into the week the things that you would like to see. I want you to take authority over every situation, over every circumstance that you will encounter this week. Father, I declare that this week is a week of favor to me. I declare, Lord, that your help shall be available to me at every time. Father, I have run through a troop by your help and over a wall. This week, every snare that the adversary will set for me, Lord, they will fall into themselves. I will run into the clear and I shall be safe. This week, Jehovah God of glory, I shall succeed exceedingly in all I set my hands upon. I shall labor little and my reward, Lord, shall be plenty. This week, Lord, I shall be a news bearer of the kingdom to many. I shall speak, Lord, Father, of your Son and my Savior, and I shall bring many to his light and to his shining, out of the darkness of this world, into his marvelous light. Thank you, Father, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. The prime timers are reminded that their meeting happens on the first floor in the seminar room immediately after the service. Prime timers, you know yourselves. Please go up to the seminar room afterwards. Let's share the grace as we close. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. God bless you.